importance of central heat, right? I'm Susan Kent. I'm the state senator from District 53, so I represent the same area that Representative Ward does, plus the other part of Woodbury. So I represent the whole city of Woodbury in addition to the South Maplewood and Oakdale and landfall. Just want to thank everybody for being here. Looking forward to hearing what you guys have to say, talking a little bit about what we're thinking in terms of how this next session is going to take shape. Starts a day for a month from today. Hard to believe that February 25th is a month from today. So it'll be here before we know it. We're all already working hard, getting organized, because it is going to be a short session. If it goes the full length, it'll be about 2.5 months, and that'll be pretty quick to get a lot of work done. So look forward very much to hearing your thoughts and having a good conversation. Thank you.
Good morning. You're in my district. I'm Leon Lillie. I represent North St. Paul, parts of Maplewood, and then parts of Oakdale here. So I think I wouldn't mind just telling them Kent Otis is here from the city of Oakdale.
Yeah, okay. Two of us.
And Stan Kroski.
Nope.
Two couple local superstars.
Thanks everyone for coming.
And you know, Oakdale does a great job. What a great city, and hats off to you. And you know, I'm on the capital investment committee, and I've been all over the state in the last year. It's been really fun, and it's going to be a big part of the upcoming session, the capital investment committee. And but you get to see a lot of cities, and Oakdale is one of the best run cities. Hats off to your administrator and your staff, and your council is stable and works well together. So it's a credit to you all. So I'm in my fifth term in the legislature, and I'm running for re-election this year again, and I would like your support. It's an interesting place. I really, you know, a lot of people play golf. I don't play golf. I run a lot with Denny. Denny was a runner, so we. But anyways, I really enjoy it. It's a fascinating place. I don't know if anybody likes to read books and study things and learn a lot of different things. That's pretty much what a legislator is. You'd like to go in there with your little expertise, but you don't get to play in that little court all the time. I have, you know, skill set that I'm more comfortable in, but then you're like forced to learn about water, you know, and you learn about, you know, other issues that you just, and it's actually really pretty exciting. But there's some good things going on. I'm pretty proud. If you drive down Highway 5, speaking of capital investment, you can see that fire training center. That's a big joint venture with Oakdale and Maplewood and a lot of communities around here, and the buildings are coming up. And Senator Wiger and myself really fought hard to get that money, and we're trying to get some money again now for phase two. So that's a really exciting development. There's going to be some things in the bonding bill. The governor has in his bill some money for Tubman, which I'm very excited about. And now this is something you don't have to hear about. But if you do, it's a very important mission that's going on right here. And the governor's committed a couple or quite a bit of money in the past, and then this cycle again. And then we're going to try to do our part to get it to the end. But it's really a good work. It's for domestic abuse and other different things. But anyways, I'm kind of talking too long. But it's thanks for having us. Oh, I want to introduce my star staff. Mary, she's going to kill me. I'm going to say right now I'm the luckiest legislator in the building. She is amazing. She makes me look good. If you call, to be quite honest, you're not always going to get me, but you're going to get Mary. And she does a great job and makes me look very good. And I can't buy her enough coffee and stuff. So, but thank you, Mary, for being here.
Can I just do real
quick? I was just going to say, then we need to introduce Gwen. You introduce Gwen.
And then Gwenya Fiscal is right back there. She's my legislative assistant. And same comments. We're in a slightly different building, so she's the best in the other building. But if there's anything,
we're going to have some competition.
if you need anything from my office in particular, or with question cards or anything, Mary or Gwenya can take them and handle anything. So thanks.
And I particularly wanted to thank both of them for being here this morning. There are some index cards that the ladies have, and if you need a pen, I had one floating around here for a while to for you to write some questions. There are many of you here. Leon alluded to some of the things that we need to address in the legislature. And in a conversation with my son about a year ago, that was after the legislature started, and I commented on the array of things that we need to be experts in, the array of topics and issues that we need to be aware of beyond anything that a private citizen would ever care about or be aware of at all, unless it was something that impacted you directly, and how it can easily be overwhelming. But fortunately, we have resources at both the House and the Senate to help us come up to speed on things. We have constituents like you who will say, hey, I need you to pay attention to this. I need you to know about this. As many of you as there are in the room, multiply that by 100, and you haven't touched all the subjects that we need to address. And we need a lot of help to do that and to do it well and be effective. And we work really hard to do that. We need our staff, but we need you as well. So you all could each have a different topic, and we would be here far longer than we can manage. So the ladies are going to help us synthesize your questions and concerns, try to put them together in a way that's that makes most sense, and we can cover the topics that at least the majority of you want to. And I think you've probably picked up already that if we don't cover something well enough for you, if you want to talk with us more, then please do get in touch with us. My LA could not be here this morning, so I'm very grateful that the other ladies came in and helped. I want to finish my thought about all of the things that we have to pay attention to. And I said, you know, things that the average citizen is just not aware of. And he said, Mom, that's why there's a representative. You have to be there to pay attention to all of those things for everybody else. Okay, I get that. Yeah. And I think about that periodically when the waves of, I mean, you know, huge tsunami waves of information are coming at us. I've got to be able to focus on those things and come up with some reasonable responses. So,
they're sorting through.
Oh, they're sorting.
Questions. Would you, I was thinking maybe we could talk about our committees and sort of what we think our individual priorities will be this session.
Sure. Leon, why don't you start?
Well, before I get going, I want to introduce Steve Hunt. He's also on the school board here, and we've got a great school board also in our community, and they're doing a good job. And I'm a big fan of the, you know, you hire a superintendent, and I think she got superintendent of the year and does a great job. And I see her at a lot of events, but Steve, you're a, how many kids you have?
Six.
So he fills up like a whole bus himself. any more coming?
No. Unless you've got some more room at your house.
I'm in my rookie season as a grandparent, so I'm kind of excited about that. So it's kind of a little distracting. My daughter, my oldest daughter, had a baby and 2 months into it. So if you want to see pictures, I can do that. Getting pretty good about that. I mentioned that I'm on Capital Investment Committee, and that I asked to be on it. I asked the speaker, can I be, you know, I actually fought to try to get on that committee. And a couple reasons. The number one is to try to help our local area on projects, to have a voice at the table in a, you know, a little different position. But I also wanted to see the state, and it's really been fascinating for me to tour. We've been on all over, and then I'm all over to the way to the north, to the south, and the water issue is a huge issue in the state. It's just fascinating. You know, we have Wiper Lake that doesn't have water, and then there's, you know, there's massive situations of flooding in our state. So to be honest, sitting here in my little home in North St. Paul, I didn't really know that we had, you know, all this water issues till you really, you know, tour around and see. In south eastern or western Minnesota, where they're actually talking about piping water into Minnesota, Worthington area, because we don't have water down in there for the farms and the ethanol plants and other industries that are down there. But so I'm on that committee. I'm also on a legacy committee, and that's the committee that spends we've just been joined by Senator Wiger. He's been busy at this other meeting, but we'll get him, let him settle, and then he can. But so I'm on the Legacy Committee, and that's a couple of years ago, the voters approved tax, or you know, where you, when you, part of the tax goes to the outdoors, to hunting and fishing, arts and cultural projects, parks and trails, and history and clean water. So I'm on that committee, and so that's interesting. On taxes, and certainly taxes are going to be an important discussion this year. We're in a fantastic situation with a surplus. So, you know, that's going to help. So we're actually looking at peeling back some of the taxes that we implemented last year. And I think that's a work that we can all embrace and figure out how to get that done. And then, I don't know, I guess there's other committees too, I guess. I kind of want to spread it around.
You want Chuck to say hi?
Yeah.
Hi. I apologize for being late. I'm just returning from the White Bear Lake, Matamida area, where we were discussing the lake level at White Bear, and that's part of this great district as well for District 43. So, have you been giving, you know,
just a little background of what you're...
2 minutes?
Yep.
Okay. I am in my 18th year as state senator for this area, and some of you know I served on the school board for many years before that, chairing the school board. Education has always been my highest priority, and as a state, students are our future. And to that end, I chair the E12 Education Finance, and the E is for early education. Senator Kent's a very active member of that committee as well, both the policy and finance. So in that role, working with schools, with students, parent groups, and I will continue to do whatever we can to provide the resources for schools to complete their mission for preparing students for the world's best workforce. There's a number of initiatives that we did last session for all-day kindergarten, some additional opportunities to close the achievement gap to help all students, but particularly for more students to be ready for K and early learning. And so that was a significant item. So a lot of work that I do is in education. We obviously multitask if it's on environmental or other areas. In terms of the big issues of the session, the bonding bill, which there's probably been reference to, nearly $1 billion, which is within our 3% guidelines for prudent investment of our overall budget. And I'll be sponsoring the Tubman proposal at the Tubman Domestic Violence Center in Maplewood, which is a regional center. It's formerly the Benedictine Monastery. The nuns had that. And it's been converted into a campus for Tubman. And on the second floor, they're looking at providing some shelter for human trafficking, sex trafficking victims. And the governor has put that in his budget. So very pleased about that. There's also, you had mentioned on the public safety, the regional training center, and again, be working with the legislators to get that done. Proposals for Fisher Creek and Century College, which is very important, will also be a part of that mix in the bonding bill. There'll be many other proposals as well, but the budget and bonding, continuing our work in education, will be my focus for the upcoming session. So thank you for being here, and we'll stand open for questions.
Well, just a minute. We didn't want you to ignore your addition.
And you did. Okay.
Just real quickly, because I do have the honor of serving with Senator Wiger on the E12 Finance Division, I'm also on the E12 Policy side, and then on the Higher Education and Workforce Development Committee. So I am really, I think, in a great position to be able to look at the education question all the way from early childhood through lifelong learning. And so as a part of that, and again, what Senator Wiger was referencing, we really did make some important strides last session, and what I think is so important is that we continue to build on that. One of the things that came out of last session is something that's referred to as the world's best workforce, and that includes 5 pillars that make that up. I'm really focusing on 2 of those in particular, one of which is
third grade literacy, one of the things that research is showing us is that if we can get kids really reading well by third grade, then they're ready to continue the academic success that they need all the way through their lifetimes. But if we miss that critical stepping stone, that's really important. So that's something that I've got a number of initiatives that I'm going to be working on. And then the other thing that I think is important, this goes back to my involvement with higher education, is the bridge between secondary and post-secondary. And that's kind of all-encompassing. It's making sure that our kids have learned what they need to learn by the time it's their turn to graduate from high school, so obviously there's what goes into that. And then it's counseling them and helping them have access to information and resources so that they can really make their own best decisions and plans that reflect them and smart decisions about their futures. We've done a number of things this past session that's going to provide more information to students so that they can do that, but we need to make sure they have the trained grown-ups in the school buildings to help them interpret that and know what their options are. And the other part of that is then understanding what their post-secondary options are so that they make good decisions about, you know, majors and training programs and understand what all the options are and how they're gonna pay them. There's a lot of attention to student debt. We did a good job this year because we've capped tuitions at all the state universities and MNSCU institutions. But one of the biggest sources of that debt can be when they pick the wrong pathway and they get in there and they take a bunch of classes and they realize that, hey, this isn't for me, and then they have to kind of double back. The more we can help everybody plan carefully from the beginning, it's gonna help solve a lot of these problems. And then the other thing that I am real involved in, I'm the vice chair of the Transportation and Public Safety Committee, and this is gonna dovetail with the bonding discussion. One of my big initiatives is the Gateway Corridor, which is the bus rapid, it's all officially still being figured out, going through the process, but it is very likely the data showing that it would be a bus rapid transit line that would go from Union Depot in St. Paul, coming out here essentially along the 94 corridor to Manning Avenue. And so that's the kind of thing we need to help spur development out here. That'll affect Oakdale, that'll affect Maplewood, that'll affect all the communities out this way. And it's a really interesting project. I encourage everybody to pay attention to it. The Gateway Corridor Commission has a website so you can follow it. They are encouraging people's involvement. They're going through a whole public commentary stage right now. But it's exciting, and it's the kind of thing that is gonna be real important. And there's one other thing I was thinking, so that's the bonding piece. Oh, one other piece on bonding that I wanted to mention is at Metro State. Not directly in any of our region, in our communities, but really important to this region. They are the only institution in the metro area that doesn't have a science building. And if you think about how much science training goes on there and should be going on there for our healthcare, which definitely affects Maplewood and Oakdale and St. Paul and Woodbury, and also 3M and all the other technological work that's out here. So that's a real important one, and I think that's so indicative of the kinds of things that we've seen both in the governor's bonding proposal and the proposals we're looking at. They help us, they're helping us build towards our future. You know, these are investments in industry and in jobs and in workforce, and so that's where I think it's really important, and that's where I want to focus my attention. Thanks. JoAnn's got a... Did you have something to add?
Just because to cover, well, a couple of things. First of all, I just wanted to inform everyone, we have a gentleman here who comes to my town halls and very faithfully records, does a video recording that then he posts on the internet. And this is what we signed up to do. I just want you to have the information to know that when you are talking, your presence here may be recorded. And then available for other people to see and hear. So thank you, Dallas, I appreciate it. I'm on the Health and Human Services Committee, so we have some big issues to be dealing with. And I will respond, I'll tell you what I'm working on, and then as it comes up with questions and your issues and concerns, then we can talk more about it. I'm on both the Environment Natural Resources Ag Finance and the Environment Natural Resources Policy Committees. So we have big hearings going on, not only about water, but nitrates and the dead zone in the Gulf and what Minnesota contributes to that. And so it's groundwater, surface water, the transpiration of the what goes back up in the atmosphere or that comes back down and where that is and what it's carrying and how that impacts all of our health. That's a smidgen of the volumes of stuff that we go through on those committees. Tuesday, for instance, we will be talking about landfills and what happens with those and the wolf hunt. both of which are tend to be very emotional and volatile issues. Let's see, what else was I going to say?
Other committees are on?
Yeah, the two policy committees, finance and living wage jobs. That's another hot issue. So we get to talk about all those things.
I'm sorry, what was the last one?
Living wage jobs.
Thank you.
Yes. Which is distinct from the economic development piece that Susan was talking about in terms of, actually it's part of it, but it's really focused on what's happening in our economy. You know, we hear a lot about people who are not being able to get the really good paying jobs, what's happening to our manufacturing and our industry and what we need to do about that. But in the meantime, we have a lot of people working at very low wage, and how does that impact our whole economy, because most of these people then end up being dependent on public assistance of one kind or another. So is it corporate welfare or is it people welfare? One way or the other, you know, we have some big conversations about that.
That's a really good segue into a question. We've had a few questions on the minimum wage. Do you support House File 92 to raise the minimum wage to $9.50 by 2015?
Yes, since I was talking about that. If we had kept up with the economy over years, our minimum wage would be about $10.50 an hour. We don't even have a federal minimum wage that meets that yet. So people who have been working at minimum wage, and these are not just 16-year-olds, you know, working a few hours a week at McDonald's. These are people who have families. These are people who have education. These are often people who are involved in healthcare. There are a lot of low-wage healthcare jobs. Many of them are personal care attendants. And most of us in this room are at least middle-aged. And, you know, in looking at our own futures, we want to stay in our homes. Nobody wants to really go to an institution, and there are people who are working in wonderful institutions, and they're not making minimum wage, or what we would consider. Some of them are in small organizations, so they don't qualify to meet the federal mandates for minimum wage. So they're making less than $7.50 an hour. Many of them are immigrants, which is allowing them to work and get back into, you know, to learn the language, and they're providing wonderful service. My in-laws were both here in very nice institutions. We had wonderful care for them. But these people don't make enough to live on. They have transportation issues, those kinds of things. But we have people who have come from other countries with serious, I mean, highly qualified medical training. And yes, and they are caring for people at a much lower level because that's where they can work for now. These people are supporting families. They have education. And we have people who have grown up in Minnesota who are working in these jobs. They've been educated here. They have some of them have two-year degrees, some of them have four-year degrees, some of them have advanced degrees, and they're making below minimum wage. Now that is reflected in our lack of other kinds of jobs, which is being addressed in other areas, but the impact of those kinds of things on our society are really significant. And one of the concerns that I have about that is what it does to children. Minnesota has roughly 25% of our children living in poverty. And I think that's shameful. That's not acceptable. It's not okay. The poverty, we understand, has, you talk about early childhood, we know what happens to the developing body and brain under poverty circumstances. The stress, the lack of basic resources, then there are things that can't be recovered or recovered easily. And then we get in trouble with kids in being in school, and we say, why are these schools failing? Well, the kids don't have what they need from the very beginning. It's a long and complicated story. But the short answer is I support that, the raise in minimum wage. And, you know, if we could, I'd take it higher. I would also say we will be, the committee will be getting a report out, and I will be giving that as at least summaries of it in my update so that you can see that. We have very strong data-based research, well-documented research, that raising the minimum wage does not negatively impact the rest of the economy. You will hear people say, well, you know, I will have to lay people off. And the truth is, what happens is you don't have the turnover in your business. So you don't have to be retraining people, and you know, it even saves paperwork in terms of what happens when you hire a new person or when you have someone leave. You've got paperwork to deal with. If you can minimize all of that, and especially the training of new employees, if you have retention, then you save money. And you can give it to your employees, and they'll be more satisfied, and they'll stay longer. And you have better employees. So I think we need to raise the minimum wage.
Just a real quick sort of recap of where we left things after last session. It was we had a conversation about this in my office just yesterday, because this is a very big and important issue for this session. The House passed the bill that would have raised it to $9.50 by 2015, and the Senate passed a bill that went to $7.75. And so, because, as we all remember from Schoolhouse Rock, you have two different bills and they have to come together and then they become law, right? So that's where it is. And sort of what we were reflecting on is, you know, the chairs of these conference committees, have they been sitting in that room for 9 months waiting for us to get back and focus on this? But that's what's going to have to happen. Those conference committees are going to have to get back to work and figure out how this is going to get resolved, because that's where it's left. And then it all has to get finally voted on again and signed into law, whatever happens. So I just wanted to put that in context. JoAnn, I think, incredibly well articulated the concerns and a lot of the complexities about the problems of our wages being too low. And, you know, when I have business owners come up to me and express their concerns that, well, if I have to raise my wages, and say there was one gentleman who owns a chain of, you know, what they call fast casual restaurants, where you go up to the counter and you get your food and you go sit down. And, you know, that's going to be really hard if I have to pay people more. And I said, think about your business. If we have more people in the pockets of people in the middle class, one of the first things they're going to do is take a night off from the kitchen and to go out to eat, and they're not going to Kincaid's. They're going to go to places like yours. So what it means is the ripple effect in our economy. And so we have to figure out how we do that. And I am supportive of raising the minimum wage, but it is an intricate balance between the federal minimum wage and other states. And there, you know, there is a tipping point somewhere. There is a point that is too high. We just can't really articulate what it is. And I agree with JoAnn, and I understand that the research says that, you know, we can raise the minimum wage and it is not necessarily going to cost employment. But my two questions have been, and I keep asking people to help me with research. I'm doing my own research, but I'm asking people to help me with research on this. For one thing, the context changed after the first of the year because a number of other states did raise their minimum wage, and that took effect January 1st. So we're in the process of rerunning those numbers. But at $9.50, under a 2013 scenario, that would have made Minnesota have the highest minimum wage in the country. And I confess, from an economic development standpoint, I get a little concerned that that will chase businesses either away or discourage businesses from being here. If there's the big sign that says Minnesota has the highest minimum wage in the country, I'm a little worried that that becomes it works the other direction. It's a question. We don't really have the information on that. There is research, and that's what we're looking into. The other side is, the eastern boundary of my district is 3 miles from Wisconsin. And so if our minimum wage is significantly higher than Wisconsin's, this is a question of mine, is it going to cost my district jobs? And if I can be reassured that it won't, then that makes it easier for me to vote for a higher number. So my point is, these numbers, this, all this discussion is going on. I'm going to take this very seriously because I absolutely believe that we have to get the wages up, but it's a question of how. And yes, some of it is the minimum wage, but it's a question of how far. So I don't actually have an answer, and I'm not trying to weasel out of that right now. It's because I'm still doing the work on it and trying to understand it before we have to take a vote. So thanks.
Chair Winkler, right, is your chair. I've sat on the House floor for a couple of years by Representative Winkler, and he's quite a neat guy. He's from Bemidji, and he ended up going to Harvard. And I don't know how many people there are that start in Bemidji and go to Harvard, but he's a neat guy, and he's been all over the state discussing this from the House side, and I'm sure the Senate's doing the same thing. I guess I haven't followed theirs as much, but I've been following him and having discussions with him and hearing what they're talking about. I don't serve on the committee, but it is a really interesting discussion to follow, and the impact. I serve on the Commerce Committee, and to see, you know, so I have an opportunity to spend a fair amount of time with employers and to hear what they say. And so, you know, we have to figure out, you know, how to do it right and to do it so it's, Minnesota is doing really quite well nationally, and we want to make sure that we keep that up. We don't want to, you know, to stop what we're doing. But at this point, I have to be honest. I mean, if it's, I'm definitely strongly leaning towards a yes. It's not going to be a hard vote. I voted for similar things, and I really, for some of the reasons that Representative Ward mentioned, I don't know how people live, you know, quite honestly, on the, you know, like a minimum wage. I mean, if you really do the math, if you really look someone in the eye and, you know, you get it on the paper, say it's a checkbook, and you say, how are you going to live? How are you going to buy health care? How are you going to buy gas? How are you going to, you know, whatever you need to succeed? So it's kind of sad to me, and a lot of it circles back to what he's working so strongly on and with the education. You know, our kids are, and it's not so much, you know, I look around the crowd, but, you know, we're pretty, it's a pretty white Caucasian group, but the minorities in our community are really having a harder time, and we need to figure that out. Our population's changing, and we have to have honest discussions and give honest opportunities for kids in the future. My kids, you know, we live in a basic home in North St. Paul, but, you know, I hate to say this out loud, but, you know, our house is really hooked up. I mean, with the internet, but you could go to a house right next door and, you know, they just don't have the same opportunities. So those kids are at a competitive disadvantage. And a lot of that is money, you know. So I choose to spend that money on technology and to give my kids opportunities. And I think it's, you know, revealed itself in their opportunities. But, you know, I want that same thing for the kids next door. So that's, I guess for me, that's why I would strongly lean towards a yes vote on that. So.
Yes, I support increasing the minimum wage. And by the end of the session, there will be an increase. Details regarding training allowance and quarter impact, nursing homes, some of the things that have been flagged in earlier discussions will be vetted further, but I do support it. I believe one of the most significant problems in America is the increasing divide between the haves and the have-nots. And it threatens our democracy. It threatens people's hope. Their right, I believe, to have an expectation that if they have a job, that they don't have to be in poverty. I support the minimum wage increase.
All right, so we also have a few questions on MNSure, and some of the things that people have been asking are, you know, the issues with the administration. Over time, these things will be fixed. Are you committed to the basic fundamentals of the ACA, access, affordability, cost, and quality? And, you know, people are concerned with its sort of bad kickoff so far.
You want to start this time, Chuck?
Sure, Min. Yeah. Min Governor Dayton for taking prompt action once it was clear that the rollout of MNSure was not acceptable, and ordering that it be reviewed and come up with some recommendations to get it right. And it needs, in terms of the overall policy goals, absolutely. In terms of access to affordable, quality care, I believe every American should have that right. And it has been the most significant domestic problem in our country. And rather than focusing on why it may not have worked, let's see how it can work. The mistakes that have been made need to be corrected, will be corrected, and we will get through that. But let's not throw it all out and then just say we're now, you know, we still have the basic problem of lack of affordable health care. Work out the problems, and the governor has taken responsible prompt action on that, and now it's time to continue to make sure they get it right.
I don't really have much of anything different to say. It's been a tough rollout. I mean, clearly, I'm really proud of the work that the Democrats have done in the last session. I think we've done a great job. I think we can hold our head high, but clearly, this has been bad. And but we're gonna figure it out. There's people that aren't, you know, they're gonna bring out the worst of it, and keep stressing that. You know, should we throw it out totally and go federal? I don't believe so. I think we can figure it out. I mean, I think about Target right now. I mean, do you shut down Target because they had this credit card problem? I mean, do you, you know, it's bad. It's a, you know, certainly a disaster, but is it, you know, I mean, no one says, you know, let's shut down Target and, you know, go to, you know, just close their doors. I mean, so I think we can figure it out and make it work. And clearly it's an embarrassment for all of us, and I'm not, you know, I'm not thrilled that it's going this way. I think it's going to be a problem for us, you know, as you know, the study said it's going to keep going for a while, but the intentions are good, and I think we're going to figure it out, and in the end we're going to have good health care, and it's going to work.
I'll just reiterate what Senator Wiger and Representative Lillie have said, you know, that, you know, no doubt there have been a lot of bumps in the road, and nobody promised there wouldn't be. I mean, I think we all acknowledge going through the process that this was going to be complicated, and we were, you know, forging new paths here, and that was not going to be without problems, and, you know, obviously we need to keep working to fix it. Two observations I want to make that sort of reflect on another aspect of the question. One is, I am glad that Minnesota did our own version, you know, that we are in control of what works for us, and it can customize to the standard of excellence that Minnesota's had in healthcare for so many generations. And so it's important that Minnesota have its own system, and that we keep working to make it good and to work for Minnesota. The second thing I just want to reflect on a little bit, and this goes to the bigger question of the Affordable Care Act. You know, it is, nobody's going to say it's perfect by any stretch of the imagination. But I believe that so many of what people would point to as its flaws are because of what it tried to do. The flaws, many of the flaws happened because we tried to work within the private insurance system that we already had. And so, you know, when you're trying, it's a little bit of a round peg square hole situation, but I think that was an admirable effort to try to do that, because I think it is too disruptive to try to dismantle what we've already established. So it is actually, frankly, a fairly conservative approach in that way to say this is the system we've got, but it's not working. You know, the number is that a percentage point of Americans every year were losing employer-based insurance coverage. So what we grew up with in terms of our families having employer-based insurance coverage is nothing like what we have now. So that system was broken, and it was failing, and something had to be done. And I think this was, you know, a good start, and we just got to keep working to make it better.
I'll second all of that, and then just add only that I've been able to do a little bit of my own research on this because my younger son is an ER doctor in Pennsylvania. We'll be moving here this next summer, and I toured just last Monday, toured the University of Minnesota Medical Center, the medical school there. And we had marvelous conversations about the changes that are happening in response to the growing need and understanding for more efficiencies as well as more thorough and effective medical responses to situations. So my son sees what happens when people don't have health insurance. I get to have a lot of good conversations with him about the kind of care, the crisis management of situations, of chronic situations that could be better managed with preventative health care that we'll have through either people will have either through the ACA or through MNSure. And we need to fix it. There's no doubt about it. But there are some really good parts to it. And like any situation, whether it's education or your own family structure, your house, anything, you build on the assets. You build on the things that are working, that are good, and you fix the things that aren't. And that's where we need to be. We're going to fix them.
The next question has to do with transit and buses. One of the questions is sort of like, why buses? And any conversation about extending into Wisconsin due to all the traffic that comes in from 94 from Wisconsin. And while the Eastern Metro area is contributing financially to mass transit, we are not seeing benefits. And please, let us know how we can increase our access to transit in the East Metro.
Yep. You're the vice chair of transportation.
This is one of my favorite areas because it is so important. And I just really believe that the things that has made Minnesota successful for so long has been that we have been, in the immortal words of one of our favorite Minnesotans, above average. And that goes to education and the quality of our workforce, and that goes to our infrastructure. And we're at risk of losing that. And so that's why it's so important that we really pay attention to this issue. With respect to the specific question, I think that was focused on Gateway about why buses. I could spend way too much time in a lot of technical weeds here, so I'm going to avoid that. But I would encourage anybody to look into what the Gateway Corridor Commission has done. This is a process that's been going on for years. It has been incredibly methodical and detailed and data-oriented, and that's how it got to buses. We actually will, the projections and the modeling that they were able to do showed that we would not have the ridership to support light rail. And that, so light rail is technically still in the consideration set, but the numbers that have come out so far make it, really low probability. And that's why bus rapid transit is such a good opportunity. And the difference between bus rapid transit, which has the fixed guideway and stations, right? So people, just like with light rail or any sort of train, commuter rail, you go in and you buy your ticket, you pay for your entry before you get there. So when you get on the vehicle, you just walk on. You don't have to worry about people fumbling with cards and money or anything like that. So it makes it a much more efficient process, which helps ridership, which makes it much more efficient overall, right? So it's those kinds of conversations. Do we put a stop here? Do we put a stop there? How many stops do we have? The fact that it's these stations are level. Like, I used to live in New York for a couple years at the beginning of my career. You just walk right on. You can push a stroller right on. You can push a wheelchair right on. This will be the exact same situation. You just get right on. You don't have to climb up. You don't have to lower the bus for a wheelchair or something like that. Again, efficiencies that help people who need access, which is hugely important, and it helps ridership, which makes the whole system more efficient. So that's how we've ended up at BRT as the most likely scenario at this point. It's still in the process for Gateway. But in the meantime, the entire transit system includes the balance of BRT, arterial buses, and other rapid bus lanes that will be created throughout the whole metro area. We will still continue to have the express stops that we do. They may be altered once we have Gateway coming in, but we will continue to have that infrastructure there. And the question about the East Metro, it's our turn. Is my short answer to that. And I want to reassure everybody, and JoAnn and I were at some meetings last week, all the way up to Congresswoman McCollum, there is huge awareness and attention that it is our turn. One of my personal pet gripes is that when you look at the Met Council or MnDOT's maps, they all stop at the St. Croix River. But for any of you who, like me, get on 94 in the morning and you see the traffic, I think I see a Governor Walker shirt over here, every third license plate is a Wisconsin license plate. So we have to factor in the fact that our metro area is bigger than just the seven counties that are in Minnesota. Even though they don't pay income taxes in Minnesota, they still are part of our sales tax and our infrastructure and our road usage, and Minnesotans need us to pay attention to that. And the question about why we're not going across the river yet with Gateway is because it is a dedicated guideway, and the current bridge that is 94 will not accommodate that expansion yet, so that would be a further down the road. Sorry, transportation always goes to bad puns, every single time, but that will be down the road.
And a
federal issue, because as we've all seen, bridges across the St. Croix River do not come easily, but that's all I'm going to say about that.
To add on that, and a kind of a question, the video is on the website.
Yes,
right?
Yes. Okay. There are videos on the website that talk about, and you can see the route that is being discussed that is not set in stone yet, but you can see the route that's being discussed, and you can see examples of BRT and what it looks like. And I encourage everybody to take a look. It's really cool, and the work that's been done, and the bodies from the entire East Metro, it's a joint effort of Ramsey County and Washington County, all the cities, private sector, the various chambers, everybody's involved with it, and it's really exciting to see so many stakeholders coming together and working on that.
So in just a few minutes on that website, you can watch that video and really get a better picture and remember what Susan has said and say, okay, now I get it.
Yeah, it's different.
Because it's different than just hearing the language about it. The visuals will really, really help. Senator Wiger, would you like to introduce your assistant before go ahead? Because she's coming in.
We introduced
our assistants.
Oh, my legislative assistant, Caitlin Snyder, and just recently occurring, my committee administrator will be Nancy Livingston, who serves on the North St. Paul Maplewood Oakdale School Board. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. All right, so if you need to get a hold of him for committee or for his office, these are the people to get in touch with. Thank you. Now go ahead with Rapid Transit.
Very thoughtful, thorough answer, and I agree.
Leon, did you want to add something?
I agree also. I just, one of the things I want to mention is that I'm kind of pretty proud of what Senator Wiger and I have been able to do on Highway 36. I mean, if you look at Highway 36, there's a lot of new cement there. At Margaret, at English, 61.
Not at 120.
It's coming. You know, or whatever. As we figure it out, and we're working on that. So, I mean, there's a lot of new cement, and I spend a lot of time with Chair Hausman, and she definitely cares about the East Metro, and she's advocating for transit around the state. And believe me, she's very thoughtful. And does a great job, and is going to work with her Senate partners and do good work. And the East Metro is we're finally figuring it out and fighting together, and scratching for what is ours.
I will add one word to that, just for you to plant in your brain, is the comprehensive transportation plan. So that we're not saying, oh, it's our turn, poor us, we're really looking at the economics as well as the social infrastructure that will be impacted by a comprehensive transportation plan that will include the east side, and not just because everybody has to somehow think west is better, because we know that's not true.
What's coming to Oakdale in the future, such as businesses, as Panera's or clinics like Elena, and do you have any idea of what's coming next?
That's a good local question.
Yeah.
Yeah, I might say just prior to that, we have sponsored a number of bipartisan proposals for tax increment financing. We're so much aware of the blight that had been at Tanner's Lake, right in the shadow of 3M, and up by across from Kmart, and there's just wonderful progress that's being done. But we carried the message to help provide some development tools, and you're making great progress. So our role as a partner in helping provide a climate and some tools for you to attract businesses and other things, and maybe Councilmember Kowalski, you could share some of the latest.
Right. Thank you. What's nice now, too, is we have four representatives
the two from the Senate, two from the House with the redistricting. So even though they're helping out areas of Woodbury, Maplewood, North St. Paul, but have four representing Oakdale, that's always helpful. And like Chuck had said, they've been really key partners to help infuse some vitality to areas such as the Oakdale Mall site and down at Tanner's Lake are our two best. We would like to get a really nice restaurant on the water. We're focusing on that down Tanner's Lake. There'll be some other things there, but that's our main focus. But all you can do is, and again, with the TIF money and such, it's made it a little more desirable place. We're trying to actually, ideally, we would work with Maplewood, and we'll continue to have those talks with some troubled areas right there that aren't in Oakdale. So in the ideal world, you'd redo that whole corner. The Oakdale Mall site, we've got the waters of Oakdale going in, really a more complimentary senior living. That was part of the plan. That's only 20% of the plan, so there's potential for another restaurant there. We'd really like to maybe see some jobs there, because we don't want to be another Woodbury where it's just retail, 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 and things get busy. So we think we have a nice bedroom community. We have other sites in Oakdale. The problem is, even though the economy is getting better, there was overbuilt, there was a glut of commercial properties in the metro. So it's slow to come. We do think the two sites I mentioned, Tanner's Lake and the Oakdale Mall site, are really some of the best sites in the metro area as far as access to major freeways. So anyhow, that's I wish we could get things more quickly, but it does take private partners to make those dollars come to Oakdale. Thanks.
Can you get rid of Quick Trip, because I've put on about 10 pounds since they've opened it.
That's a nice addition. The nice thing about when economic dollars come to your city, then the Holiday gas station is equally as good. They've upgraded, and there's actually a difficult site because of wetlands right near Menards and the Quick Trip that is targeted for like a restaurant, could be maybe a Perkins type of thing. That's going to be really slow to come. But over on the Lifetime Fitness, that's where we have the Alina Healthcare. There's a lot of really good property there, so we hope that also loosens up. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any questions? Follow up on that?
I was just going to segue in, perhaps Senator Kent could comment on her leadership for carrying the research development capacity for 3M. We all know its significant role in our economy and our neighborhoods and the spinoff economic impact it has, you know, for businesses in Oakdale and nearby. If you wanted to.
And I'm just going to reflect, because this was my first session, and just jumped right into a few of these things that and Senator Wiger and Representative Lillie and former Representative, now Mayor Slawick, had worked so hard on some of these things. It is so regional. And so when we started with the Oakdale TIF project, which was one of the first, and we talked about its proximity to both Maplewood and 3M and Woodbury and the intersection of 94 and 494 and 694, this is so interconnected. We are one important little region right here that is so interdependent on each other. And then to get the chance to work on the 3M R&D building, which kind of went back and forth a little bit, but again, a really great partnership from both the state level and the city level, and then the corporate level. 3M is really recommitting to Minnesota, including at the center. And part of this agreement and this deal was that the wages in that R&D facility will be an average of $50 an hour. So these are real jobs, and the way 3M is structured, so they do a lot of the R&D here, which then trickles out. I mean, they keep it here locally on purpose, right? And then they do that all goes out into their international marketplace. But then a lot of times they'll do the R&D here, and then they'll do a lot of the sort of initial manufacturing and test driving of products down in Cottage Grove, and then a lot of these things they've added jobs up in like Hutchinson, I think, and Alexandria. So this is a real recommitment, not just to the center and not just to Maplewood, but to the whole state. So it's really positive, and that was why it was important to everybody that we work on that. But in addition, they're donating land to Maplewood to have a fire station right there in that facility, which is so badly needed, Kim, in yes. South Maplewood, absolutely. So again, it was a wonderful opportunity for all these things to work together and come together for this whole area.
I want to add just a little bit to that. My husband is retired from 3M, and he was recruited from the University of Washington years ago to do research. And I remember coming to Minnesota, and you know, some of us grew up here and some of us didn't. And so we're transplants and we love this place. And I remember going to his new workplace in the early 70s and thinking that lab building was kind of shabby looking then. It's still the same lab building. and in terms of reinvestment in the future, there are a couple of pieces that I want to pull together here. 3M is looking at a huge turnover in their employees. They're retiring. They need to now, and they are going to, in the next 10 years, need to be hiring new research scientists. Kids coming out of Harvard or wherever are not going to be feeling really good about going to this building that was shabby 40 years ago. And it doesn't have the research facilities, it just can't, doesn't have the capacity to do the kind of research that we need today. So they really need some new research facilities, which of course they could build anywhere in the world. We want them to stay here, they wanted to stay here. Another piece of that is the transportation. Looking at the demographic changes, people, young people, don't necessarily want to have a car and sit on the freeway for 45 minutes like Susan and I do driving from, you know, our 7.5 or 9 miles at most to the Capitol, and that's on a reasonable day. Get into snow or anything else. These kids don't want to do that. They are not going to spend their time, young people, I shouldn't say kids. Young adults are really wanting to spend their time, we don't want to spend our time that way either. They want to get on transportation. They're used to it. That's what they want to do. And Susan and I, so there is a stop at 3M, there's a stop at Sunray. That's in the plans anyway. Susan and I were at a Chamber of Commerce event several months ago and ran into a businessman who said, I would love to open a restaurant, I think. 300 employees in the East Metro. I can't get my people there and back. Until you get transportation, I can't do it. And that, I thought of that when you mentioned we need to have a restaurant, we don't, you know, but it's gonna be a long time coming. Part of that is connected to the transportation. So it isn't, there aren't simple answers. There's not just one size fits all or one issue. They're all interconnected.
And if I could mention something on the wrap, the transit that Susan mentioned, it's so key to the vitality of the, you know, it's not set in stone, but it could potentially go kind of by the Oakdale Mall site or the Tanner's Lake site. It would go through our Carlson Business Park, which is out near Guardian Angels. That's been, got off to a quick start. The economy went dry, you know, 6-7 years ago. There's buildings that they want to get started, so that would be key to getting the workforce out there and back. There'd be a commuter stop hub to take care of, like you say, the people from Wisconsin. So that rapid transit bus, which is leaning toward that. In the ideal world, I just hope that if it's so successful, you know, whether you like light rail or not, I'd hate to end up something short that we wish we would have maybe been to the next level 15 years from now or something. That's my concern.
Next question has to do with the Safe and Supportive Schools bill or the bullying bill. There's questions on whether or not you would support it, and then concerns about parent that there is a parent notification or about the anonymous reporting that may increase harassing students. So would you support it? And what about concerns regarding parent notification and anonymous?
I'd just like to say first that I am not on either of the committees, so I'm going to let these other people talk more. Both the senators are more connected to the committees who are working on this, but I am also working on it. And so if any of you have concerns, I would be happy to talk to you about it.
I strongly support the Safe and Supportive Schools Act. I'm the past chief author of it, and Senator Dibble has taken it over the past couple of years, and I anticipate it will pass. Every student, every staff person, every parent, anyone that enters a school building has a fundamental right and expectation to be safe, yeah, period. And if there is an abuse of that, it needs to be promptly reported to parents. And there is so much suffering that has gone on. We hear it from parents and others. You know, many schools, I want to say, are doing a great job. And you'll go right in and it will talk all about respect in one another and zero tolerance for not respecting people. That you are expected to treat people the way you would want to be treated yourself. So right now we have a 37-word statute that has districts put together a policy, but it's been ineffective. There was recent information that came out on the school climate, and I think they said like over 2% of the students feel scared going to school each day. And it shouldn't happen, whether it's right or wrong, who's right and all that. You know, it's a major concern that we have, and we have set aside some funds to help in best practices. I can tell you that this comes right to home in Oakdale and Maplewood, and I can't tell you how many stories and tears from people where they've had to go and leave the school because of that. There's some language that we'll continue to refine in terms of any unintended consequence, or if there is an action that may not be, you know, deemed reportable, but we are very serious about this and it will pass.
I think Chuck outlined a lot of these issues really well. We heard this bill several times over the last session, and it's sobering. It's heartbreaking. I was a PTA president before I started doing this stuff. I've heard these stories firsthand, and it's just, it's not okay. I mean, we've got to do better. And the 37 words hasn't been doing the job. And I give full credit to Senator Dibble and others who have led this effort, because they have been so responsive to stakeholders, to school administrators, to principals, to parent groups who've said, here are our concerns, and as he was saying about the unintended consequences, and that bill has evolved. So a lot of the criticism that I hear about it, I'm like, have you read it recently? And it's even been being worked on in the interim, and so I look forward to seeing where it stands now, because it is about being responsive to these very issues. I'll say quickly on the issue of parental notification, as a parent of a seventh grader and as a former PTA president, I really raised my hand on that with a concern, and they made some changes to try to make sure that we were not leaving parents out of this discussion. But the reality is, and part of what this is trying to address, is in some cases talking to some of these parents might not be the safest thing for kids. And so it's trying first and foremost to protect the kids, and but to obviously be responsive to families as well. So the process on this has been incredibly thoughtful and serious, and always about keeping kids safe. I just want to add that you will be hearing, if you read the bill, you'll see restorative justice. And if you do not know what that is, I would encourage you to delve into it a little bit more. It's something that I've been working in for 20 years, and currently having some conversations with county attorneys about drug issues. It's something that I worked in schools for 9 years, using restorative practices to do prevention, early intervention, with all sorts of social interactions, bullying, as well as kids just having trouble for one thing, one reason or another. I would encourage you to pay attention to the terms restorative justice, because you're probably going to be hearing more about it. And if you have questions, give me a call.
All right, the next question has to do with the Minnesota Orchestra and how it was nearly destroyed by a lockout. And this was a lockout, not a strike. And a major problem seems to have been the lack of community and musician voice on the board, which effectively was unaccountable to anyone but itself and elected its own representatives. Can the legislature intervene? Because this is may seem like a small issue of interest to only a few, but it's like a community resource, like a park or a historic site, which depends on support to exist.
Go for it.
It's not necessarily a pure legislative issue, but they've historically gotten money from us, funding for different things. There's a group of us that wrote a letter that encouraged them to settle, and I think we were just in the process, weren't we, Mary, of writing another one when they did settle at the end here. But whether those make a difference or not, the letters or what we were doing, but at the end of the day, you know, you're never certain. It's interesting, my daughter goes to a music school out in Boston, and one of her professors says, hey, what's going on in Minnesota with your orchestras? And so I was like, wow. And so, you know, people are paying attention in that community. It's fascinating how much money, you know, some of the arts community that comes from the state, you know, the Legacy Committee, for example, that I'm on, and capital investment a couple of years ago. So we've, as a state, have made an investment in the arts. And part of it is somewhat we've talked about just a few seconds ago with 3M, for example, or I see my daughter back, or my daughter, my sister, with TCF, you know, but some of the big companies that we have in the state of Minnesota is, you know, having an arts community, having parks and trails, that Len Price does so many good things about, but, you know, having this orchestra is part of our fabric that makes Minnesota great, the education system that Senator Wiger worked so hard on, and those sort of things. But the end of the day, you know, you would hope that they would treat their employees well, but I don't know that we had a really strong, you know, we can't go, and I don't believe that we could really, you know, tell them what to do. But there is some sticks that we had by, you know, the future funding. You know, they have, you know, whether it be through the legacy funding, so they were definitely concerned that the chair, Khan, was, you know, perhaps not going to look fondly in them in the future. And, you know, so those are serious concerns for them as they look into the future. So I don't know what, you know, whether the letter made a difference or not, I don't know. But we did send one out, and we were in a process of doing another one and trying to get them to treat people right. And so anyways.
All right. 26 or more states exempt military retire pay from the state tax. Both Wisconsin and South Dakota are among them. Some exempt all pay, others exempt a portion of $10K to $15K, etc. Consider this exception. Do you have any thoughts on that?
I have sponsored it twice in the past. It's almost made it to final passage. It hasn't. It's a matter then of making up the lost revenue. But I do support that, and I know that there are a number of retired veterans that have elected not to reside here because of that competitive tax difference. So I have supported it and will again.
Okay. Do you support the labeling of genetically modified organisms or GMOs and products so consumers can make an informed purchase decision?
We're falling into committee category.
Yeah, we are. there is a lot that's not really known and understand about GMOs. And if we think about how some of it has been going on for far, far longer than we ever imagined, The short answer is yes, I do support it. As long as we don't know, we know we don't know. So I think we need to at least give people the opportunity to make an informed choice about whether or not they want to have it or not. We still don't know what we're buying, but at least you can choose whether or not you're going to participate in that. I will say that if everything were labeled that was modified, you'd be hard pressed to find something that wasn't. Mm-hmm. it's getting harder all the time. So I think that it's an issue we need to pay attention to, but we still don't know a lot about it.
I'll just expand a little bit on my views on this issue. I agree, and JoAnn described this really well. I think one of the first things we need to do is understand and define terms so people can really understand what that means. Because right now, the idea of genetically modified is it's too big of an umbrella. And so I'm all for transparency and people knowing what it is they're eating and buying. But we're not there yet, so we got to get it better before we're in a position to make that actually be meaningful and effective.
The legislature is considering judicial retention elections with appointments versus election of judges by the people. Which way would you vote and why?
You guys have more experience.
I support the law as it is. And I believe that the public should have a direct voice on the election. I know there's been a bipartisan group that has suggested that we change that. In effect, what happens now is most judges will never face a real election the first time. They usually get appointed after there's a retirement right before the end of someone's term, and then they go through a committee of peers, which is good, but it really doesn't go to the voters for quite some time. But once you are incumbent or there, it's highly unlikely that you'd ever be defeated. I am not convinced that we should change the law. I've talked to a number of judges in Ramsey County about this, and they agree as well. That doesn't mean it's the official position of the district court, but I don't support a change.
Would you be willing to support legislation ending the electoral college so that the president is elected based on a popular vote? 10 other states have already passed this legislation.
It's not going to happen. I'm aware of the impact of the, I just soon keep the Electoral College at this point because of the, and I recognize the, by winning the popular vote, you don't necessarily become president, but it's based on those states that may not have huge populations and providing them a little bit more representation in the balance. And and further, there's been so many attempts, and this is it's not going to happen in our lifetime. It's been discussed a number of times, so but no, I don't support a change.
And then there's a question regarding if there's any bonding bill that would help her with homelessness.
That would be yours. So the bonding bill, I think, there's a variety of bills going forward. So the governor has his bill, the Senate has theirs, and then the House has theirs. And in the House, I think we have $55 million for housing issues. And one of them I mentioned earlier is the Tubman facility, which is an unbelievable opportunity for, and that fits into the housing component. And then Senator Clark from Minneapolis is leading the effort on much of the housing, and so there is a big package of for affordable housing that's in the bill right now. But just going back to Tubman, it's really a great project, and Senator Wiger really covered it in more detail than I did, but it the buy, the building that the nuns have offered us for this opportunity is just amazing. It's actually a piece of art itself, the building. It's, if you get in there, it's this cement. I mean, you could actually probably drop a bomb on the thing. But it, and I don't know, I'm not an architect, but it's just beautiful. They have these corridors and with arches, and it's amazing just with cement how the place can be so beautiful. And the people that are going to be going there are going through some tough times, but they offer amazing services and great opportunities to get out and fight for a new day. But so there is quite a bit of money in the bill right now, and it's in all bodies, and it'll be moving forward, I'm certain.
Stay tuned.
The exact number, I'm not certain.
It's the process.
Would you support the 5% campaign bill to increase funding for disability services by 5%?
Yes.
Absolutely. Yeah. There's been just so many people, and I put these in the have-nots, the people that might take care of you someday, or a loved one, a parent, and oftentimes no benefits, struggling with poverty, check to check, and it's a matter of dignity, and they deserve that 5%.
And we did a lot in education last year. We did not really do that much in health and human services. And when we talk about raising the minimum wage, some of these care providers are going to be directly affected by that. And we've capped what we can pay those areas. So there's going to be a bumping into a ceiling if we don't address this. So this could help work some of these issues out.
Okay, I have two hyper-local questions and one I don't fully understand. First is, what is the plan for sidewalks in Maplewood?
Totally local issue.
Yeah. Okay. And we don't have any Maplewood leaders here, I don't think.
No. And we don't have any impact on that.
Yeah, it's pretty transparent. The website for the city, and just email, call, the phone numbers, and contact information's there, and then they can tell you, but it's a local decision.
All right. The second one, in Oakdale, is the senior housing co-op by the 10th, or excuse me, is the senior housing over by 10th Street a co-op?
Kim, you want to
go ahead?
Yeah.
I wouldn't understand fully what a co-op concept would be in a senior housing, but I don't believe it is. I think it's just a private for rent place. It is a little more higher end, someone that's a little more affluent with some retirement dollars. That was partly strategic because we have a really high quality building and we wanted other high quality buildings to come to the site. Plus we've had a nice allotment of different types of senior housing. So good in your community to have potentially different income level type senior places. In fact, we have a potential one on 94, which would be the American Inn, is looking to convert that to senior housing.
Okay.
It's a bit of a trouble. It hasn't been the best place to have a motel. And we do get a little bit of trouble from that motel. So it's too early to say if it'll happen, but we'd all like it to happen. It's just some zoning things we have to have. That might be more of a definitely a modest income. In fact, it ties into some of the things where might be some state level or county level funding there to make it feasible for somebody that needs some help to have a place to live in their older years. Mm-hmm.
Okay, we should take the last 5 minutes for any kind of wrap up, final comments or anything.
Could I just say
Price.
Something?
Yes.
I'm a constituent, but I'm also a lobbyist. So I spend a lot of time at the Capitol. And I just like to let everybody that may not have time to be there to advocate for an issue or an entity. These are wonderful people because they're so accessible. They're always willing to sit down and talk to you here in the district or if you come to their offices. And they're people who are very calm and collected, and reasonable. They really do a great job of looking out for us. So I know all of them personally, and I just want to publicly say thank you.
Other questions?
Let's go. Do you have a chance for one more question, I guess?
You got power. This is your city.
No,
you
no, no.
And you got the police behind you, so.
Lyme disease, there is currently a moratorium there that Representative Detmer up in Forest Lake and John and Marty in Roseville are the two that are going to bring it forward this year. There's a moratorium on just how the, read my wife's notes here, she has Lyme disease, protecting people that have long-term Lyme disease. Washington County has the highest concentration of Lyme disease in the state of Minnesota. The CDC had been publishing that they had been approximating 30,000 cases a year. They went back and changed their numbers to 300,000 cases nationally a year. So they underestimated by, you know, whatever, 900%. So if you guys would talk with Representative Detmer and Senator Marty when that comes there, it's going to be an important issue. And I know there's a lot of people in Oakdale and in Washington County that are really suffering from the whole Lyme disease. They've come a long way with the treatment, but we still need to continue
moratorium to. Moratorium on what?
Yeah, there was a moratorium on doctors treating long-term Lyme.
Okay,
so
yes.
There was a perception out there that once you were treated for Lyme, you were cured.
Right.
And it had to be something else. Well, now the medical community has come kind of full circle and said, no, there is long-term Lyme disease. And this is where that moratorium ends this year. So we would really need your support in at least continuing that moratorium or furthering that cause.
Thank
so
you.
Didn't want to take up any more time than that.
Thanks
sure.
For
sure.
Thank you.
Yep, and there's some information on the state Lyme organization. Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you guys for coming to the city. Yeah, today this was terrific for the residents.
Thank you. And I we endorse what Len said about how approachable they've been over the years. So.
Just a very brief conclusion. Thank you for sharing part of your life, part of your Saturday with us. You have our contact information. If there's any need for follow-up, you know we'll do our very best to get right back to you, and if you want to talk in private about anything, you know, just let us know that as well. Thanks for the honor of representing us.
Thank you very much for coming. I really appreciate it. Great turnout on a beautiful, sunny day. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
There's some information in the back, too, that you can pick up if you want, like, committee structures and how to do bills and ideas, some federal offices and that sort of thing.
I'm sorry.